so this is fine. Yeah. We'll have a we'll be here.
Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Stuart Langhorn, and I'm the church warden here. And you're very welcome here this morning to our service on the 16th of August. I noticed as a teacher that as soon as I stood up, some people stood up very straight. It's not necessary, but very much appreciated. It's lovely that you're here to join us this morning, and people are joining us on Facebook as well. Please do mention us in the comments so that we know that you're with us here this morning. It's very nice to have you here, whether you're joining us on Facebook Live or whether you're here with us here in the service this morning. Thirdly, our rector is away enjoying a well-earned rest. We presume she's still in France. Is she still in France?
She's back.
So she's just not joining us this morning. She knows what's coming. So if you want to leave now, you can do so. They're all still singing. So we're very welcome that she's managed to make it back from France. Let's start our service this morning. We come from scattered lives to meet with God.
Let us recognize God's presence with us now.
As God's people, we have gathered. Let us worship God now together across the miles yet joined. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We come to our time of confession. In the light of Jesus, let us examine ourselves and confess our sins. Take a moment to allow the Holy Spirit to bring to mind anything from the past week where you want to say sorry to God. Father, we have sinned against
heaven and against you. We are not worthy to be called your children. We turn to you again. Have mercy on us. Bring us back to yourself as those who once were dead, but now our life through Christ our Lord. Amen.
May the Father forgive you by the death of the Son, and strengthen you to live in the power of the Spirit all your days.
Amen.
And we come to our first hymn. We're still in a time where we cannot sing, but we can enjoy this time of worship. And if you wish to stand, do so. If you wish to remain seated, that is fine as well. If you wish to come along, that is allowed, but our first hymn is Be Still for the Presence of the Lord. Our first hymn.
Thank you.
lovely to hear the humming. And we look forward to the time when we're able to sing again. I know for a lot of us, we want to be able to sing, and it's just very difficult that we can't be able to sing. But the time will come eventually. And the collect for today. Lord of heaven and earth, as Jesus taught his disciples to be persistent in prayer, give us patience and courage never to lose hope, but always to bring our prayers before you, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And Celia will now bring us our first reading from Romans.
The first reading is taken from Romans chapter 11, verses 1 and 2, and 29 to 32. The remnant of Israel. I ask then, did God reject his people? By no means. I am an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham, a tribe of Benjamin. God did not reject his people, whom he foreknew. Don't you know that Scripture says in the passage about Elijah how he appealed to God against Israel? For God's gifts and his call are irrevocable, just as you, who were at one time disobedient to God, have now received mercy as a result of their disobedience. So they too have now become disobedient, in order that they too may now receive mercy as a result of God's mercy to you. For God has bound everyone over to disobedience, so that he may have mercy on them all. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us.
You are seated
at the right hand of the Father. Receive now our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Please remain standing for our Gospel reading, which faith will read.
Gospel reading is taken from Matthew, chapter 15, verses 21 to 28. The faith of a Canaanite woman. Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him, crying out, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." Jesus did not answer a word, so his disciples came to him and urged him, "Send her away, for she keeps crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." The woman came and knelt before him. "Lord, help me," she said. He replied, "It is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. Then Jesus said to her, Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted, and your daughter was healed, and her daughter was healed at that moment. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Beth and Celia, for your reading. Now please be seated. Well, as I said earlier on, my name is Stuart, and I'm a church warden. And usually at this point, for those of you who know me, you will know that I usually ask for some volunteers, but because we're socially distancing, he can't switch his device on. I don't know which means he can't be able to talk about it, so that's good, isn't it? Oh no, it's a thing, you shouldn't have. Come on, there we are. Right. So, but no, today we've got a quiz instead, because, oh Mary, excellent. So, we've got a quiz because, there we are, Lord help me. Yeah, there we go. Because we're going to have a look at Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 to 28. I often think when Beverly, our rector, goes away, she leaves me the most difficult bits of the Bible to preach about. So I hope we follow today's two readings. Yes, there's lots of nods going on here. Matthew 15, the faith of the Canaanite woman or the Syrophoenician woman, depending on which translation of the Bible you were having a look at. But we're going to start with a big quiz today, a big geography quiz. Okay? So, there's lots of excitement going on here. So, for the next hour, we're going to have a look at the faith of the Bible. So, we've got some questions going on here. So, first one, here we go. We're going to look at some geography in the Bible. Now, usually at this point, we'd be asking for some volunteers, but we can't do that. So, you're going to mark yourselves here. So I'm going to trust you. Yes. You've got the look of a year 11 class on a Friday afternoon. Yes. Particularly you. So here we go. This city borders the Sea of Galilee. Okay. Which one is it? Which one is it? C. We're going for Capernaum. Not sure the only answer. It's C. It is Capernaum. Okay. Who got that one right? Put your hand up. Oh, very good. Right. John baptized in this river. Okay. Who's going for A? Who's going for B? Who's going for C? We get the idea now. Right. Who's going for D? Okay, let's reveal the answer. It is C. Oh, all feeling very strong now, right? Okay. The four rivers, the river heads of Eden were. I'm going to get more difficult now. Right. Who's going for A? Who's going for B? Who's going for C? Who's going for D? Okay. Who's not got a clue? Okay. It is? Ooh. C. Right. Number five. The Egyptian army was destroyed in this body of water. Where were they destroyed? Who's it A? The Rio Grande. Good. Number B. The Nile. C, the Red Sea. None of the above. Go on then, where was it? It is the Red Sea. Okay, number six. Where were the 12 spies sent out from? A, Kadesh. B, Jericho. Yeah, where were they sent to? Canaan, yes. Somebody whispered at the back, it was Canaan. Yes, they were sent to Canaan from okay, so that's where they sent out from. At 7, the capital of Assyria, where Jonah eventually preached, where was it? Was it A, Nineveh? B, Babylon? C, Jerusalem? Or none of them? Okay, where was it? It was A, Nineveh. That's where he went. Okay, 8. Where did Esther live? A, was it Babylon? Was it B, Jerusalem? Was it C, Shusha? Or D, where was it? Ooh. 9. Where did the sun stand still? Patmos? Egypt? Gibeon? Or none of them? Okay, reveal the answer. Gibeon. It's in the book of Joshua. It's a battle in the book of Joshua so they could defeat the Amorites.
Do you know the answers to all these?
Yes.
Oh,
yeah, I did the quiz. Which city boasted the temple of the great goddess Diana? Was it Ephesus, Athens, Rome, or Jericho? Okay, reveal the answer. It's Ephesus. It's in the book of Acts. Anybody been to Ephesus? You've been there and seen it?
Yeah.
So, Ephesus. It's in the book of Acts. St. Paul visits it. Right, okay, thank you. Okay, now you've marked yourselves. You know how many you're right. Is it? Oh, my dear. So, we're going to have a look at the faith of the Canaanite woman. And why have we done a quiz on geography? That would pass the time. Well, we've survived last night's thunderstorm. Did it wake anybody up? Somebody slept through it. Who slept through the thunderstorm last night? My goodness. Didn't know it happened. Gosh. Well, it woke me up. It was stunning. Did anybody get up and watch it? No. Still managed to get here this morning, so well done. Well, over the last few weeks, we have been looking at the book of Matthew. And we are continuing this week to look in chapter 15 of the book of Matthew and Jesus and the Canaanite woman, sometimes called the Syrophoenician woman. And the same passage appears in the book of Mark. But why does the gospel writer Matthew put this passage here? Why does it take place here? Where does this actual story take place? So if we go on to the next slide, we can see where it takes place. And that's why we've done this little quiz on geography in the Bible. Where is Tyre and Sidon? Why does Matthew mention where Tyre and Sidon are? Well, they're actually not in Israel at all. Tyre and Sidon are in the neighbouring kingdom of Phoenicia. And they're right at the top. You probably can't see where they are, but where it says Jesus' ministry, can you see that? Yes, Tyre and Sidon are there, the two red dots. One is Sidon, that's the bit at the top, and Tyre is the red dot just below. So Jesus, in the bits we've just been listening to over the past 2 weeks, Rosie's talk, What did Rosie talk about? What story did she talk about? You didn't realise I was going to test you, did you?
Feeding of the 5,000.
Rosie talked about feeding of the 5,000. Well done. And what did Beryl talk about last week? What story did she talk about? Oh, what did Beryl talk about?
Walking on water.
Beryl talked about walking on water. So where was Jesus when those events took place? If Jesus was walking on water. She was near the water. Which bit of water do you think it was? He was near the Sea of Galilee. So the Sea of Galilee is the blue bit. Not this big blue bit, the great sea, the Mediterranean Sea. He was at the Sea of Galilee, which is the other blue block. So he's gone from the Sea of Galilee, and he's gone to where those two red dots are. So he's left Israel completely to where our story is taking place. So sometimes geography in the Bible is quite important because it tells you where Jesus has gone. So he's left where he was, where Rosie and Beryl's talks were, and he's gone. Oh, well done. So he's gone up there. That's where he's gone for today's bit. Okay, so that's where he's gone. Now, why has he done that? Well, in chapter 14 of Matthew, something quite dramatic has happened. And what has happened is John the Baptist, his cousin, has been beheaded. That's what has just happened. And you might remember the story. Salome has been dancing in front of Herod Antipas, and she has requested John the Baptist's head on a platter. And that's what has happened. And Jesus has heard the news, and it says in Matthew 14, when Jesus heard what has happened, he withdrew by boat to a solitary place. But when he gets to a solitary place, what happens? The crowds followed him. How many were there? 5,000. And Rosie told us the story of having to feed 5,000 people. So the story of the feeding of the 5,000 takes place when Jesus has just heard the news that his cousin has been beheaded, and he feeds 5,000 people. After he's fed the 5,000 people, he tells the disciples to get on a boat at the Sea of Galilee and to row across the Sea of Galilee because he's still wanting some time to reflect on what has happened to his cousin John. And the event of walking on the water and Peter walking out to him that Rosie told us about, Beryl told us about, happens. And they land on the opposite side of the Sea of Galilee. And immediately what happens there is the men of that place recognized Jesus and sent word to the surrounding country. People brought all their sick to him and begged him to let the sick touch the edge of his cloak, and that those who were touched were healed. So the crowds come to him again. At the start of chapter 15, things get worse for the grieving Jesus. Then some Pharisees and teachers of the law came to Jesus from Jerusalem. And they ask him, why do your disciples break the tradition of the leaders? They don't wash their hands before they eat. It's almost like they did in our time. Why aren't they wearing a face mask? Jesus responds that it is the Pharisees that do not keep the law correctly because they do not honour their fathers and mothers. And then some Pharisees, and he calls them hypocrites. He says this, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules of men. And he says to his disciples, what goes into a man's mouth does not make him unclean, but what comes out of his mouth is what makes him unclean. And after that, He withdraws even further away out of Israel entirely. And he goes to that region of Tyre and Sidon. Why does he do it? Well, I reckon what he wants is to get some peace and quiet. John has been killed. He wants to mourn his cousin's death. Maybe Israel's getting too dangerous for him. He's followed by crowds everywhere, and the Pharisees constantly questioning him. He wants to reflect on what has happened. But clearly the crowds want attention from him all the time, and it's just not possible for him to be able to reflect on what has happened when he's around the Sea of Galilee. How often are our lives like that? We need time to reflect upon what God is saying to us. And yet around us, no matter what we do, and no matter how well-intentioned we are, things press upon us. It could be family, it can be work, it can be Facebook and the media. Sometimes we just need to take a break and listen to what God has to say to us. In Jersey, that can be quite difficult. Like Jesus, when we go out, we sometimes bump into people that we know. And we get recognised. If we want to take a walk just to listen to what God has said to us, or we're on the beach in the hope of some quiet time, we bump into people and they want to have a chat with us. That's not to say if next time you meet me and I ignore you, it's because I'm trying to have some me time with God. It might just be because I'm short-sighted and I didn't see you. Or it might just be because I'm a miserable Yorkshireman and I just don't like seeing people. But sometimes it's just difficult to have that quiet time with God. And it can be quite difficult. So perhaps we can see what Jesus is doing here when he goes to Sidon and Tyre in order to withdraw and be quiet away from the crowds. Do you want to go on to the next slide? But what happens when he gets there? A Canaanite woman from the vicinity came to him crying out, "Lord, son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is suffering terribly from demon possession." He gets there to be quiet, and he's not left alone. Notice the woman has not brought her daughter with her. The person who needs their help isn't actually there. This woman is not Jewish. She's a Canaanite. She's a descendant of the people who originally lived in Israel. So Joshua had been told to kill all the Canaanites when they went into Israel, but he didn't. So she's a remnant of that, if you want to go on to the next slide. But Jesus doesn't speak to her. The daughter, if you notice in this slide, is actually in bed. She's not there. The disciples want her sent away. She keeps crying out. She's making annoying noises. Jesus turns to her and says, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." In other words, not to you Canaanite people. But she persists and she kneels before him. Jesus tells her, it's not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. So if you want to go on to the next slide. This seems to be a really uncharacteristic thing for Jesus to say. Commentators explain that Jesus here knows that God's kingdom will extend to the Gentiles, to the non-Jews, but it's not the time yet. Other commentators point out that the Greek word for dog here is that of a lap dog, not of a dirty street dog, so it's not quite as harsh as it sounds. The woman retorts, "Yes, Lord, but even the dogs eat the crumbs from the master's table." And that's quite a witty thing for her to say, and it provokes Jesus into doing something. Jesus says, "Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed from that very hour. We never actually see this daughter, but she's healed. And if you want to go on to the next slide. Some commentators will talk about the faith of the Canaanite woman that heals her daughter. But really, this is not what the passage is about. If you want to go on to the next slide. Today is not about imploring you lot to have faith like the Canaanite woman. What I think this passage is about God's grace. Grace is a gift given freely by God, even though we don't deserve it. And that's what connects it with the Romans passage we read. God's gift and mercy are irrevocable. The crowds who followed Jesus were impressed by his teachings and miracles. They were drawn to him by his charisma. Some received his grace and made that commitment to follow him. Others went away feeling that they'd seen a good show. How often do we come to church wishing to be entertained rather than wanting to receive God's grace? If you want to go on to the new side. The Pharisees knew nothing of God's grace. They felt they were following the rules. They would make themselves right before God. But they didn't understand the spirit of the rules. They could never receive God's grace to fulfill them. But we need to learn lessons from that. Merely enforcing rules that hurts others is not good enough. And we need God's grace and love to see how people are affected by our actions. The disciples struggled with grace. Whilst Jesus was with them, they often got it wrong and had to have things explained to them. In this case, they wanted the Canaanite woman gone because she whined too much. Grace was for them, but they found it difficult to share. Can we learn from them? As we move out of lockdown, things will be difficult, and it'll be different. We have to share our service online. We have a camera in church. Do we have the grace to welcome new people who are at home, to put up with new technologies and new ways of working? As a church, I think we've done really well. In this story, there's an underlying current of race. And during the last couple of months, Black Lives Matter has also been a challenge for the church and for the island community. What does the passage say for us there? On to our next slide. And finally, the Canaanite woman. She understood grace and was ready to accept God's grace freely. And perhaps it's her example we should follow.
In our prayers this morning, there is a response. So when I say, "Lord, hear us," will you please respond with, "Lord, graciously hear us." Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Dear Lord and Father, we bring you our thanks and praise at this time of our coming together to worship. We pray for the church around the world and for Christians everywhere. We especially remember the churches and Christians in Beirut who have lost or have damaged their places of worship in the devastating explosion. We remember the leaders of our church as they try to restore new patterns of worship which conform to the regulations for social distancing. We think especially of our cathedral choirs and all the other church choirs who can no longer raise their voices in praise. We hope that time will come when we will be able to sing again all together. We pray for Archbishop Justin, Bishop Trevor, Dean Mike, and our Rector Beverly and her family weekend of remembrance, we give thanks for all those who served in the 14th Army in the Far East, fighting in the war against Japan. We remember their sacrifice and hope they know they are not forgotten. We pray for all those endeavouring to bring peace to our troubled world. And we pray for those now tasked with developing and producing vaccines which will help the world to live with the new pandemic of COVID-19. Lord, hear us.
Lord, be gracious to hear us.
We remember all who are sick or troubled at this time, those fighting disease, those who have become unemployed. And we especially pray for our young people, whose academic year and future prospects have been severely impacted by COVID-19. We rejoice with those who have achieved the results they wanted, but empathize with those who see injustice and unfairness in what they have been awarded. We hope that solutions can be found for them. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
In a few moments of quiet, we remember those we feel fall for the most, those in our hearts you may wish to mention out loud or in the quietness of your heart.
Nick, Trevor, Flo, and Alan.
As a congregation, we pray especially for Lucy and for Doreen, ill in Lermitage. We give thanks for the life of and mourn the passing this week of Wendella Heck. We ask God's blessing on Pip, Dick and their family, and her brother Robert and his family, as they mourn the loss of a much-loved mother, grandmother and great-grandmother. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
We give thanks for the life and service of Princess Anne, the Princess Royal, on the occasion of her 70th birthday. She is a true friend of Jersey, especially the Zoo, and represents the Crown with grace and commitment. We also rejoice with our church almoner and treasurer, Beryl, as she and Robert celebrate their golden wedding tomorrow. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Around. There is a plate at the front of the church as you come in on leave. Cheryl, and the gold wedding. If you want to give a round of applause. Church will be open on Wednesdays from 9 a.m. To 3 p.m. for private prayer on Wednesdays, and on Sunday next week there is a service of Holy Communion at 9:30, which our rector Bev will be leading. We hope that you are enjoying our online services. And should you wish to make a donation, the details are on the slide there, or you can give online, as we have said, and the details are on the Facebook page. The service itself is available on the Facebook page, or will be available on the YouTube page, which comes online during the week. Our final hymn, if you wish to stand, is I heard the voice of Jesus say. Please stand. Final blessing. God, through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, has given us the victory. Give you joy and peace in your faith, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.